Welcome to ZooCast UK, filled with news, views and information about UK zoos, safari parks, aquariums and other animal parks.
We start with some conservationists who are heading out from Bristol Zoo to Costa Rica to spearhead vital research into a tiny endangered frog.
The reason that they're important to us is that their population has declined over 80% in recent decades, making it very, very important to understand what the remaining population size is and their distribution. And we'll be listening for their calls. They make a pretty distinctive call. And we'll also be surveying ponds and other areas where we know they like to breed. So we're looking for habitats that they are traditionally found in. So we'll be going into the Central Valley of Costa Rica, which is in between this sort of chain of volcanoes, and surveying some of the national parks there that are at the right elevation for these frogs. If we find the frogs, which would be fantastic, we will start to plan more concentrated data collection and monitoring activities in those particular regions. If we don't find them in any of the parks that we visit this time, we will expand our search to some of the neighboring areas.
Unfortunately, the lemur leaf frogs have been declining in recent years, but no one's got any concrete sort of proof as to where or where they aren't currently kind of inhabiting in the forest. They live in the forest between sort of 400 meters and upwards in this sort of rainforested central valley region of Costa Rica. So we're really trying to find out if they're there and if the reports of them sort of massively declining are true or not. We're going to have to walk through the forest, we're going to have to look under leaves, we're going to have to go at night and take recordings of their calls. So there's lots of different ways we can actually do this, so let's just see which ones work.
Bristol Zoological Society is also involved in a breeding program for lemur leaf frogs at Bristol Zoo Gardens, which it owns and runs.
At Wild Place Project, vets and keepers were fighting to save the lives of three tiny, white-belted, black-and-white ruffed lemurs, whose mum was not showing any interest in them. The little lemurs weighed just 60 grams, 80 grams and 100 grams, and were getting cold and dehydrated.
Sadly, the smallest of the three died, but a decision was made by vets and mammal keepers to take the unusual step of intervening to try and save the other two. The mother was given a mild anaesthetic, then, as she slept peacefully, a team of six made up of a vet, veterinary nurse and four keepers placed the two babies on her so they could begin feeding.
One of the two remaining babies was too weak and died later, but the third pulled through and is now feeding regularly and is being cared for by his mum, who had reared two babies last year, so the complication and subsequent deaths were unexpected. It's a rare procedure to carry out, but thankfully, now the surviving triplet is doing well. Both parents are helping to look after the little lemur, and his two older siblings are playing with him.
He's growing rapidly, spending more time playing and exploring, and has already been seen nibbling at the adult's food. Which is great, since the International Union for the Conservation of Nature Red List puts white-belted black-and-white ruffed lemurs at extremely high risk of extinction in the wild. Every white-belted ruffed lemur is crucially important to the future of the subspecies, which has undergone a population decrease of 80% in just 21 years.
Another lemur species was celebrating three births at Bristol Zoo Gardens within 3 days of each other. Twins were born to mum Ethel, and less than 72 hours later, another ring-tailed lemur, Mavis, also gave birth. Ethel and Mavis, who are twin sisters, also produced babies 12 months ago when they gave birth on the same night.
The tiny babies are clinging tightly to their mums, and it will be some months before the keepers are able to tell whether they are boys or girls. The latest arrivals will be fed by their mums for the next month, and they will be carried around holding onto their mums' chests before they begin piggybacking their mums and then start to move around independently.
They will also try small pieces of the food their mums are eating, like sweet potatoes, but they will not be fully weaned for 5 months. The new lemurs mean Bristol Zoo Gardens now has 11 ring-tailed lemurs. This is really important because in the wild, ring-tailed lemurs are an endangered species. They are found only in the forests of southern and southwestern Madagascar, an island off the southeast coast of Africa, where the destruction and degradation of their forest home is the biggest threat to their survival.
Staying at Bristol Zoo for a further endangered lemur species, which was welcoming new family members. Twin crowned lemurs have been born at Bristol Zoo Gardens, but for one of them it was touch and go for the first day of its life. The twins were born to Mum Tiako and Dad Loco in the middle of the morning in the lemur walkthrough.
The first one was born fairly quickly, but the second took a lot longer to be delivered and was struggling to breathe despite Tiako stimulating and cleaning it. Keepers stepped in and quietly removed the infant. They then warmed it up and stimulated it to start breathing properly. It was then placed back with its mum. Tiako and the two babies were then moved indoors in the warm.
By the end of the day, it was looking a lot stronger, clinging on to Tiako, and since then has been feeding normally. It's very small, but thriving, although it'll be more than a year before it and its fellow twin are fully grown.
Bristol Zoo's youngest gorilla, Ayana, was celebrating her first birthday.
She's had a very good year. You know, we started off last April with this wonderful birth that seemed to be quite straightforward. Very protective mum who was doing all the right things. And then gradually over the months, we've seen her develop. You know, we've seen her teeth starting to come in, we've seen her nibbling food, we've seen her learn how to walk, we've seen her learn how to climb. And now she's turning into this really sweet-natured, lovely little girl that, you know, is a very lovely member of our troop. We have 7 animals now. We have a mixture of ages. You know, we've had some lovely breeding, and it's just a really lovely, happy troop.
Bristol Zoo Gardens is a conservation and education charity and relies on the generous support of the public not only to fund its important work in the zoo, but also its vital conservation and research projects spanning 5 continents.
The Cotswold Wildlife Park and Gardens is home to a new Bactrian camel calf called Elsa. Her mother is called Maggie and was born at the park in 1998. This is her 7th calf. Visitors can now see the new arrival in the large paddock she shares with the rest of the herd.
Jamie Craig, curator of Cotswold Wildlife Park, said, "A baby camel is always a welcome addition to the park, both for the keepers and the visitors. Elsa is growing well and has finally managed to get to grips with the tricky issue of manoeuvring on such long and ungainly legs."
The wild Bactrian camel, Camelus ferus, is classified as critically endangered by the IUCN and is thought to be one of the rarest large mammals on Earth. They were considered extinct in the wild until an expedition in 1957 sighted a small herd on the Mongolian slopes of the Altai Mountains. Today, it is believed that fewer than 1,000 wild Bactrian camels exist.
Bactrian camels are a prime example of environmental adaptation. They inhabit Central and East Asia's rocky deserts, where temperatures can reach over 100 degrees Fahrenheit, but can also drop to minus 20 degrees Fahrenheit in winter. Their thick, shaggy fur can cope with freezing temperatures, and it molts as the seasons change, allowing them to survive in the unrelenting heat. They can close their nostrils and use their double row of long eyelashes to keep sand out of their eyes. The 2 large toes on each foot spread wide to help them walk across shifting sand.
In addition to the new camel calf, miniature donkey mare Skidaddle recently gave birth to a foal, who has been named Penny by her keepers. 2 wallaby joeys have recently left the comfort of their mother's pouches and can be seen bounding around their enclosure near the lake area.
Marsupials now, tree kangaroos, whom Bristol Zoo is preparing for. Work is well underway on a new enclosure at Bristol Zoo Gardens that will see Goodfellow's tree kangaroos living there for the first time. It involves transforming an area at the heart of the zoo so visitors can get up close to these eye-catching marsupials.
The 2 tree kangaroos, called Katawa and Mian, will have centrally heated houses with picture windows so visitors can easily see them when they're inside. There will be special bridges leading from inside the roof of their house into 2 outdoor enclosures. The enclosures will have 1.5 metre high glass panels around parts of them to ensure everyone can see the tree kangaroos climbing and playing outside.
An S-shaped path through the tree kangaroos enclosure will lead visitors to a special exhibit. Exhibit Development Manager Rebecca Cole said, "What makes this exhibit special is that it will focus not only on the tree kangaroos, but also on sustainable palm oil as well." Construction of the new enclosure will continue for the next few weeks, ready for its opening on the half-term holiday. The Goodfellow's tree kangaroos are part of a managed European breeding programme.
Once they have settled into their new enclosure, it's hoped they will breed to sustain their species. In the wild, tree kangaroos have suffered from hunting and a loss of habitat. At least 1 of the 12 tree kangaroo species is close to becoming extinct. Many of the areas where they used to live have been lost to logging or timber production, or used to grow wheat, rice and coffee plants. This loss of habitat can also leave tree kangaroos prey to domestic dogs.
Keepers at ZSR London Zoo gave Meghan the okapi a royal treat to celebrate the forthcoming royal wedding.
We're here today to celebrate the royal wedding with our baby okapi, Meghan. She's 5 months old, and we've given her a bouquet of flowers to celebrate the royal wedding that's at the weekend. We've called her Meghan in celebration of the royal couple, so their engagement was announced just shortly after she was born. So to celebrate their engagement, we named her after Meghan Markle. So another Harry in our history, Harry Johnston, actually found the okapi in 1901. So to bring some attention to the okapi, we also named our okapi Meghan after Harry's new fiance, to try and highlight the issues that okapi are having in the wild. They're a not very well-known species, so to try and give them a bit more enhancement, we also named her Meghan.
On Saturday the 19th of May, while Prince Harry and Miss Markle say I do, any loved-up lovebirds lucky enough to share their names with the royal pair can enjoy a free day out at ZSL London Zoo, where they can pop in and visit the young okapi.
Staff at West Midlands Safari Park have been busy investigating the new prehistoric exhibit, Ice Age. A team of specialist staff, including expert geologist Dr. Nock, scientists and animal keepers, have been working tirelessly to ensure the area is safe for visiting guests and the new prehistoric creatures that are calling the park their home.
Since the mysterious time portal and ice cave were first discovered several months ago, specialist keepers have been tasked with bringing the fascinating creatures back from the brink of extinction millions of years ago. Now safely housed at the safari park, the team are ensuring they have everything they need to keep them comfortable and look into how this amazing phenomena has occurred.
Specialist equipment has been purchased to care for these gigantic beasts, including large extendable brushes used for combing the woolly mammoth's fur and keeping it detangled. Smaller brushes are also used to keep their teeth clean, and in the case of some, like the huge cave bear, cleaning also takes place between their claws.
Working alongside the keepers are a team of scientists who are researching different aspects of the magnificent animals. Much attention has been given to the ferocious saber-toothed cats, who have canines up to a foot long. Although they look impressive, these huge teeth are actually very brittle and break easily. The team hope to find a way to cause less dental breakages for these creatures to keep them happy and healthy.
Scientists have been documenting various samples, such as the skull of a woolly mammoth, the behaviours of a Paraceratherium and her calf, and the amount of teeth the hell pig currently has, at the last count, over 40. To find out more about any of the stories mentioned, visit our website and social media, and of course, subscribe to us on our YouTube channel.